Everybody, I want to tell you about the Red language, and it kind of relates to the Lisps, but I will still explain some things in the Lisp language so you can get this connection and to see what actually can be done using the ideas and principles which are the basis of Lisp. There are a lot of programming languages out there, and the first thing which I also ask myself is, why should I learn another one? What features does it have? And by the way, so we started the presentation earlier, so if you have any questions, raise your hand, ask right away, so we can have more like a discussion than just a talk. So, Homo Iconic is, Mike told, the idea is that the language itself, the code in the language, is the same with its own data format. So in Lisp, everything you write basically is a list, and you can easily manipulate this, right? You can find their lengths, you can add things, you can remove things, you can construct them on the fly. So the very important ones are the three on the bottom. This language is the, you can download it as a single file, 1 megabyte, contains whole toolchain, whole library, and REPL, no install, no setup. You need no packages, no libraries on your machine. No, I don't know, C dependencies, C++, boost libraries. You don't need this. This is complexity, which the idea of this language is to fight the complexity and the fun guaranteed. So the link to the language site is on the top right corner. It will be on every slide, so just for you to remember. The basics. So in Lisp, the basic thing of the language is a list. Here is the REPL, so it will show all the code in the REPLs. So you can see what I'm typing and what I get as an output. Setf, as we discussed earlier, is the thing which assigns value to the symbol. In this case, it's symbol L, and the value is the list of three items. And you can check the type of L is the cons cell, which essentially means it's a list. In Red language, it's a little bit different. Well, here it's almost the same. So the syntax here, I will explain it because I can imagine seeing the new language for you can be like, what is going on there and everything. So B colon means that we are assigning something to the word B. And blocks in the red is the fundamental data structure, the same as, basically it's the same as lists, but a little bit more fancier. You have more features on them, and I will show you later. I can make another talking only about blocks. But yeah, and the type of B in this case is a block. The next fundamental thing in Lisp is symbols. So symbols, basically everything which is not a list is a symbol. So in this case, both setf is a symbol, L is a symbol, type of is a symbol. It just, the symbol has the function value, and then it is a first item in the list. We call it as a function, but essentially this is a symbol. And here in the Lisp REPL, I'm taking the type of L, and it's a symbol, surprisingly enough. Red has the analog of the symbol is called word. That's pretty much the same. They are quoted here because if we remove the quote, the type of will be executed on the value of L, and we want it to be executed on the symbol itself. This is what makes actually makes Lisp different from like maybe all other languages, is that in your regular language you don't have the entity which represents, like, you have the variable x, and all you can do with this is use x as a value. You cannot use x as it is, as a separate value, yeah, x, not what's inside. And here what starts being a little bit different from in Red from Lisp is, in Lisp, basic list is a function call. So when you type in the command line, or if you have in your file, in your program, like parents and then some expressions inside, essentially it means that the first thing is a function, and then it applies to all other objects in the same list. They all are arguments. And in Lisp, by default, lists are evaluated, so lists are your code. In Red, it's a little bit different, so typing blocks will not get them evaluated, so blocks are just a set of things, just a list of things. And to evaluate it, you need to explicitly ask for it. In this case, the do function does it. So you pass it a block of code, and you get the result. In Lisp, the similar construct will be evaluating the quoted list. So it actually makes it easier to think of blocks as the quoted lists in Lisp. So the idea here is, by default, no block is evaluated. Then the next basics you have in the language, when you have your variables, your data structure, basically what you need are the functions. In Lisp, this is an example of common Lisp. Some Lisps can have a little bit different things in this area, but in common Lisp you define the function with a special thing called define. So define takes your symbol, which will be the function name, list of arguments, and basically list of code. The trick here is that define is the macro, so it's a compile time thing which creates the symbol f, but assigns the function which it assembled from arguments in the body to the symbol f. In Red, it's, I think, a little bit more transparent, so you just assign function to the word. So everything in Red is anonymous. You don't have names on something. So all values are anonymous, and you can assign these values to the words and then use them. You can just use the bare values if you want. But the difference here, the big one, comes with the fact that, as you maybe remember, blocks are not evaluated. So func is actually a function. So this is the difference from the Lisp. In Lisp you have define, which is a macro. And why does it make a difference? So in a REPL, if we ask help for the function, this is what we will get. It says that you just pass it the specification of arguments, you just pass it a body, and it will construct your function, which you later on may assign to something, or you may not. It's up to you. But what it means is that you can call this function as any other regular function in the runtime, and do this. Here I created the block of arguments with A and B, I created the body with A plus B, and then I created a function by calling the function func with arguments in the body. And later on I called it and it works. But the more interesting things come to later to realization that the idea of Lisp, but code is data. Data is the code. But so Mike told us about how data is the code, so how you have your data, how you evaluate it. But the other side is also quite interesting. So code is data essentially means that you can manipulate code as easily as you manipulate the data. So I think everybody knows how to add the numbers, how to concatenate strings, I don't know, how to do anything with the data using your programming language. And you can do it in the Red as easy as, even maybe easier than you would do it in Lisp. So what this thing here does is it takes body of F. I'm just explaining you the order of operations because it's not clear from when you see it for the first time. It takes the body of F, which is a block. It finds the word plus, then it changes the word the word plus it found on the word minus. Did it work? Calling F with the same arguments shows that it did. And we can check what's going on inside F. By putting colon in front of F means basically we are not calling this function, we want its value, its raw value to get its raw value. And as you can see, the body changed. No questions so far? It's very simple, easy.
So is it really compiled or it is?
Question. So this one is in REPL and everything in REPL is evaluated. So the Red language itself is totally dynamic, like very dynamic, as you can see, maybe too much dynamic. And you can do all kinds of crazy stuff, but these things, they got interpreted. And there is a dialect of that called Red system. And this is the compiled part. It looks like Red, it has some features of Red, but basically it's more like a C. So you have type declarations everywhere. You don't have this dynamic nature, but you have very efficient compiling to the native code. So these two things, they are separated in Red. In terms of like you as the users of the language, it means that you can write your code in Red, having all kinds of introspection, crazy dynamic things. And then if you find a bottleneck in your program, you can rewrite some parts in the Red system. Losing some flexibility, but gaining the speed. Basically, this is the trade-off which we're fighting. This was the last part that I showed you the Lisp, because everything that's going after it is quite unique to Red, so you will not see it in this form in Lisp. Lisps has DSLs. So the idea is basically when you have the code in your language, it's got parsed and evaluated according to the rules of this language. And in like most of the languages out there, you cannot do anything with it. So you are limited by the rules of your host language, and you cannot do anything about it except if you basically write your own language. Writing your own language is usually it's quite a complex story, but Mike showed you the Bison parser generator thing. So you have to write a parser, you have to write a lexer, you have to basically to write the evaluator which will run things which you made. And Red makes it so much easier, but it's simply unbelievable. So let's take a look at this example. The default order of evaluation in Red is left to right, no exceptions. So as you can see here, first we are getting 2 plus 2 is 4 and times 2 is 8, which is the second line confirms with the parents. But this is probably not what we are used to, right? We are expecting a different result. Red does it in a very interesting way, introducing a math dialect. As you can remember from 3 slides ago, blocks are not evaluated. So this block is passed to the function math as it is. And math actually applies rules and order of math operators, executing this block and giving you result according to these rules. You can check out the source. It's actually that easy. For some things which are built in the Core language, you cannot do it, but math is just a function, the regular one you can write in your spare time. But what we can check out here on the slides is, we are taking body of math, you should get used to it already. Mold is basically giving us the string representation of this. Then they split it on new lines and then they get lines. It's 14 lines of code. It's a language with a different evaluation rules than the host language. 14 lines of code. Try to do it in any other language. And I actually thought it would be fun to show you how easy it is. So I thought I wrote my own version. It's much shorter, it's much more simple, but it should show you the how you can do it, how easily you can do it. So what is going on here? We have a function called fortmath. Anybody here familiar with language called Fort? Okay, three persons. So the idea of the language is you are putting everything on the stack, everything which goes as an input to your program, and then you apply operators, and operators take top things from the stack, do something with them, and put the value back on the stack. So you don't really have the variables, you don't need them. So what is going on here is the function has some arguments. The most important, the first one is the code. It's a block of code, the pure one, not evaluated, so we can do anything we want with it. We are using on the third line a thing called parse. I will explain a little bit later. But basically what it does is it walks through this block of code or anything else, and then you specify what do you want to do with the things you find. And here I'm saying that I will accept any number of things. If it's a number, I will put it on the stack. If it's a word, I assume this is an operation. Then I will take two top things from the stack, and then I will put on a stack from the other part. So if you don't follow me on this line, I will take the team P1 and team P2 are the top arguments from the stack. V is our operation. I will do this block of code, so reduce basically will replace team P1, team P2 and V with the actual values. And then I will calculate it and put the result back on the stack. And the returning value of the function is last element. And next ones are two examples how to call this function. So 1, 2 plus means essentially it's 1 plus 2. Then you put 3, and 3 times 3 is 9. Same works with the float numbers, and basically any kinds of numbers, because in the middle of the function I'm matching the number type. So any numbers I have in the language will work in my own language.
Do big nouns as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
questions?
I have a question.
Yeah?
How does the line that calculates the lines of code evaluate? Because if it's always like the math on top, if it's always from left to right,
yes,
then I'm curious how does it evaluate
the
top right?
So it evaluates in this order. First length it takes one argument. So in this language, you know for each function how much arguments does it take. This is the essential thing. Length takes only one argument. Then we go to split. Split is a function and we shall call it. So we are not getting length of the function, but we call in the function split. Split takes two arguments. Then we go to the next one, mold. Mold is also a function, so we are not there yet. We need to evaluate it as well. Mold takes only one argument, and we come into body of. Body of takes only one argument as well, and its argument is the value. So math is a function, but since we put a colon in front, it will be the value for the body of function. So here we can start to reduce things. Here we get the value. Mold is the function of one value. Here we get the value. Split is the function of two arguments. So we got one, and the new line is the second. And then they're coming to the lines. So split returns us a block of strings, split it on the new line.
And the key is the colon, because the first time I saw it, so like, why doesn't it apply math to new line?
No, it's not a key. It's just
no,
getting
like
the value.
The hint to not use the function, but to use to not try to parse another argument for that function, but to use the function itself.
Yes. Yes. Because otherwise, math will try to evaluate new line as the like math expression and will fail.
But can you pass a function as an argument to another function?
Yeah.
Right.
Of course. Yeah.
But then
this
how
is
you
this is what happens.
The argument?
Sorry.
So if you want to pass a function as a parameter to another one,
yes,
you have to use colon to stop the function from reading the argument.
Yes.
That's what.
From evaluating basically.
Okay.
Yes.
Does language have optional parameters? Because in this case, you get ambiguous evaluation, right? You can get,
yes.
Is it solved only with parentheses?
No, it's solved in this case. Here's the good example. So take, it takes one thing out of the block and removes it from the block, basically returns it. So take part, this is like an extension of the function. You can think of it as the mix of optional parameters and the keyword parameters. Because take last means you want to take not the current item, but from the end, so the last one. And part actually means you will have a second argument, so it becomes a two arguments function. And the second argument tells how much you want to get. It makes language look, very concise, very elegant, I think, but of course very unfriendly for the beginners.
And
yes.
What about the infix operators like plus and multiplication?
Yeah. True. So the functions they apply in the way that you have the function name and then arguments. Things like plus they defined as the operators. So operators they are infix things. And you can define your own as well, even based on other functions. So it's very easily done in one line, of course.
And is it possible to understand from the code? I mean, with macro, at least you know that if it's macro defined, then you cannot rely on evaluation of the arguments, right? Or you check this first.
Okay.
And if it's just function, you can see how to evaluate it. And in this case, it seems like for any function, you can't do any assumptions, right?
What do you mean you cannot do any assumptions?
Because every function receives a block of code, not
something this function receives only one thing. For example, I don't know.
It's like forces code to be evaluated.
So this is example of the function which receives a block of code and evaluates it as it wants. But you can have the function which receives two arguments and, I don't know, subtracts them. It's up to you what to do. It's just that blocks, also blocks of code, are the regular thing, the same as the numbers, strings, anything.
So you don't know if the function evaluates stuff or just returns another block?
No. It's the same as you have the function in basically in any non-typed language, not statically typed language. You have only the name of the function, number of arguments. You don't know what it will return to.
Okay.
So I think it might be a little difficult to read, though, wouldn't it? I mean, like, if I ran into a bunch of code that was written in this style, like the length one there, I would have to know in advance that split takes two arguments in order to read it, right?
Yes.
There's no way to, in place, actually read the code. If you don't know the functions and the number of arguments they take, it's not readable. I have a little problem with that.
Yes.
That would be really
That's
hard.
That's true. So what this means that having this kind of very, very deep introspection in the language, you can do things like help. And in your terminal, you can make.
Okay, so you have a direct way to refer to that, and then help could be used maybe in an IDE with a pop up or something over the top.
Yes,
or something
exactly.
Like that.
Exactly.
Okay,
you can use it on anything.
Okay, well, as long as there's some way to easily get that in place.
Can you bind the value of a built-in function like that, like lexically as well? Because
this is, you're touching the very, very, very deep concept. The one I wasn't going to talk here about, but yes. the thing is, if I just scroll a little bit back, okay. So here we have body A plus B, right? And nobody asked, like, what does it mean? Like, how does the func get the value of A plus B from the arguments which are totally separate thing? It has to do something with a thing called context. So in the Red language, how should I say it simpler? There are no scopes. All you have are the context.
They were at runtime as well, right? There is a scope, there is context, but it's a runtime entity, not like in
So actually the function is very simple. You can do it by yourself like in 3-4 lines of code. What it does, I'm not sure if I should explain all the details now, but basically there is a context, and for this body A plus B, A and B, they are not bound to any context. So if you try to evaluate it, you will get an error because they don't have the value. But the func function, what it does, it creates a context, and its context with the arguments actually is the list of the things which you will have in this context. And then when you call it, it will set these things in the context A to the value of A to the actual one, B to the actual value of B, and it will bind the body to this context. And so when you evaluate it, they will actually get the values and the things.
There are also some Lisp dialects that are based on the king idea. It's called actually F expression, I think, in Lisp.
I'm not really familiar with F expressions,
but basically the idea is you don't evaluate things, you just pass them to the functions and they will evaluate if they want.
Yeah, and it's actually how I may be wrong on specifics, but it's actually how Lisp started. And it's the idea that just as functions, what would be macros can also be resolved at runtime, which you can't in a Lisp, in the sense that the macro has to appear as its own symbol, but if you have expressions, then it can be resolved at runtime, so it could be a variable, and then you don't evaluate the rest of the arguments, you pass it to the function, which is an F expression. Then that's the difference from a F expression to a function. It's just F expression, it's just a function that takes the arguments unevaluated. And that's how Lisp started, but it was seen as too unprincipled and hard to reason about and hard to optimize and all that. And one of the reasons that it was seen as too unprincipled is that because at the time Lisp was dynamically scoped, and the interaction between these two things didn't work out that well because it was really hard to reason about.
So,
and then people just got rid of F expressions. It took a while more to get rid of dynamic scoping with Scheme. But the interesting thing is that there's a guy called John Shutt, and he has a dialect called Kernel, that he argues that the problem wasn't F expressions, it was actually dynamic scoping. If you have F expressions and lexical scoping, then they behave well, and not only lexical scoping, and he has a really like thorough theoretic discussion of this. He calls it the vowel calculus, because he calls this the I guess what would be your funk, or maybe a primitive below funk,
mm-hmm.
Which is the equivalent of lambda, but for F expressions. He calls vowel, and then everything else is built on top of vowel, because vowel is the lambda function that doesn't evaluate the arguments, and then you selectively call eval on the arguments, and lambda, for example, would be built on top of that. It's a really interesting dialect of Lisp to dig
yes.
up.
But still, here, you don't have a scopes at all. So maybe it's still
but somehow funk
yes.
there is binding A to A in
exactly.
the body, right? That's
yes.
part that's
yes.
a scope. In the result, in the object that you return, there is a scope hidden there.
Mm.
Yeah,
they are different.
In kernel, the Jonschut dialect, you actually have a more you have this kind of thing as well. The vowel, this principal thing. I'm not actually that familiar with the implementation with the dialect, but I understand that you can also do this. You can create your own scopes and your own notion of scopes on top of that.
So, just to answer to your question, the big difference between scopes and context is that scopes, they have relation. So you have scope, and then inside, for example, you're creating another function to create another scope, and this child scope will have pointer or something to the outer scope, so it will continue the search for the values in
mm-hmm.
until it goes to the top level, and that's it. So the context, they are totally independent. You create a context. If something is not found there, it will not be searched anywhere else. And I think this is what allows this kind of crazy dynamic thing with the scopes. Maybe it will not work, but I'm not sure about it.
From your explanation of context, is there any difference from dynamic scoping?
Mm. Yes, there is the difference. And because dynamic scoping, you are searching for the value assigned in runtime.
Okay, and you don't
here
even know
it's
that.
Not really in runtime, but in the place where it was defined.
So
and, no. Okay, let me put it another way. Again, A plus B. Yes. So you can take this body A plus B. You can bind it to another context by yourself. And evaluate it in another context. You can bind it to any context you want, your own context you just created, and evaluate it in this context.
Oh,
not sure.
Okay. So if you have a context and you have A and B,
yeah.
you can bind to this context,
yes.
and from now on it will refer to that.
Yes. So it
okay.
has to do with something, how
okay.
the words work. So A plus and B are three words, and the words, they have a pointer to their context, where they are evaluated. So in this case, when we're creating the body A plus B, they are bounded to the global one. Okay.
Yeah.
But func rebinds their pointers to its own scope.
So it's like you're manually building like a closure. This is the environment. This is the
kind of
it's
kind
of
interpretation.
Because how can you nest functions? You cannot do that, right? Can you return a function from a function?
You can,
inherit,
of course.
But the context. You said that the context doesn't inherit from another
you
one.
You have to. Deal with it.
Okay.
You have to do it by yourself. You can do it, it's not that hard, but the abilities it gives you. So, the big thing here about dialects, in for example, in Common Lisp, who knows which dialects are there built in the Common Lisp?
Loop,
yes, one of them. Format is the second dialect. Maybe there are more, but I only know these two. And for a language with such abilities, it's a little bit small number. So for example, on this slide, you have already math, which is one dialect. You have actually parse, which is another dialect, which is a very interesting dialect. It's a dialect to create dialects. We are going to the higher levels of meta thinking. So, as you can see, parse code, and then inside, it doesn't look like a code at all. Well, I mean, for you maybe it is, but It's not a call. So any is actually interpreted by parse as you will match the next things you will encounter in this in the source, basically in the source stream, according to these rules. And this is this thing is very similar to the you know, PIG. It's called parser expression grammars. So this thing is essentially built in parser expression grammars in the code. And what is the very, very big difference from the dialect? So when you have DSLs, like dynamic specific languages, right? You have the external ones and built-in internal ones. The external ones is that, like Mike showed you before, you have your like grammar, then you pass it to some program, it generates your parser, Alexa, or anything else. Internal ones, they allow you to do things in runtime, and then allow you to do things while you are in the process of parsing. And here is actually what happens. So we set n to something which will be matched next, which is a number. This is the like number with a exclamation is the type. What is in parents is actually what will be executed according to the normal language rules. And here it's the same. And the way it is done actually is the same. So n as a symbol is being binned by the parse to the value which will be gathered as the number next from the input. And then this piece of code will be executed with the n binned to the correct context. So n will get the value which we get from, which we get from the parse. So I have few of I wanted to show you some of examples of the dialects. In Lisp, I know, in the common Lisp, I know only two. Maybe there are a little bit more, but Red goes far beyond that. So this is the Vue dialect. Vue dialect essentially describes the visual interface which you want to get. It receives as a block. As you remember, it's not evaluated. It's evaluated by the function Vue. Function Vue creates a window with the title as you pass in as a string, with the size. We want the text label on it and the button name click. This is the result which you want to get right from your terminal. Underlying things, of course, are quite complex. So Vue calls to the native libraries available on this platform, graphical libraries, and then puts things on the, like passes the parameters, the size, the string title, and everything.
There's no way that can fit in the 1 megabyte file.
There is a link over there. But wait for it, wait for it, wait for the, for
okay.
The, for the, for the end of the presentation. I don't know, you should notice how very concise and very small the description is. To create this kind of window in a C, how many lines of code do you need?
But it actually, I mean, it's part of the library, but it's not something that is only allowed by the language, right? Like, you could write very easily a Vue macro in Common Lisp as well, doing this.
Mm.
And same with the same thing for the infix syntax for math.
You kind
of
can.
A lot of people have done it, but they don't use it because they still prefer the S expression. But,
but what about the graphical dialect? We don't have any for this.
But there are libraries, and right, and you can use, like, Vue could be perfectly a function, a macro, and then you can have like keywords to title, and so you can actually do the same in Common Lisp.
Yeah, basically, because the idea of code being the data.
But the fact that the language is so dynamic, it could allow even more things.
Yes.
It would be interesting to find some example.
Quick question: how hard is it to move this button 1 pixel?
On the button here, it has a lot of parameters. I only put one, which is text.
Okay.
Later on, you can put size, offset, you can put on click, the action, and basically, what you have in the graphical system, they're trying to put as much, they're trying to get as much as you have on the host platform into the language, into the dialect, so you can use it easy, very, in a very easy way.
From what I understood, this is not part of the Red system, right? This is Red, like regular Red, a dialect
yes,
built on
yes.
top of Red.
Basically, the red binary, which is 1 megabyte, contains both red system and the red and the view dialect and draw dialect.
But since this is like an F expression like behavior, that it's a sort of it's a function that takes the arguments unevaluated.
Yes.
This is not really compiled, right? Expanded like as a compile time
so
computation.
So for the red system dialect, you have to write things in the separate files, for example. So you cannot put the regular red code inside the red system code.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit more restrictive than simply doing like all the things you want.
No, but my point was for the script.
Because the semantics is quite different, and the way you want to process them, you want to compile things to the native code. So for example, in Red system, each function you define, you have to specify the types of the arguments, like quite similar to C. So it's like a statically typed language, but it's still seen as a dialect.
Yeah, I can imagine that is different. But what I meant is, is this somehow optimized? Away the fact that what would be a macro in Lisp is actually done at compile time here.
Yes. So
because in Lisp this would be expanded to a bunch of function calls, supposing that it was a macro that didn't need to be, and there would be no indirection at runtime. Whereas if you're actually expanding these things at compile at runtime, I'm guessing that you will end up having a bunch of interactions that won't cost a lot in most cases, but in some will, I guess.
So as you can see here in my example, there is no expansion as it is. I'm just evaluating the code in the way I want. It's not getting expanded in some things because this is like runtime manipulation of the code. Common Lisp, Lisp allows you to manipulate code at compile time, at read time.
Yeah.
In runtime, a little bit more complicated. Maybe you can still do it.
Yeah.
There is like a very thin layer between compile and runtime and Lisps, but
yeah. My point: can you do this at compile time in Red?
Yes. So in Red you have compile time macros, which is basically essentially the macros you have in Common Lisp. It's just that you can do much more in the runtime.
Yeah, definitely. But then it has a cost, which is not necessarily
a
bad thing.
So
but
some
just,
things
I'm
you
just
want to, which
to
you can calculate in compile time, you may do it, but for example, to do this in compile time makes little sense, right? To have your window popping out and when you're compiling the program.
Definitely. But
so, the next one, draw dialect. I actually want to ask you to guess what's going on here. So on the first line, I'm assigning image to I, image size of 100 pixels. What's going on later on is draw takes an image, takes a block of its own things. The first one sets the current color to red. Next one draws a box with the like top left and bottom right points. Next one sets the color to green, and the last one draws a circle with the center and the radius. And we can actually use view to view this image. This is what it looks like. Red square and green circle. So what's the catch? We discussed a little bit already about things. So people don't believe it can be in 1 megabyte. Somebody thinks this language is quite interesting. Why I never heard of it before. So this language is currently in very active development. Its version is 0.62, released a month ago. It still lacks few things. Full I/O planned in 0.7. So right now there is something called Basic I/O. You can read write files and you can read HTTP. Basically, you can make HTTP queries. The garbage collection, which is quite important, of course, but apparently not yet implemented. These are, I think, two very, very important ones to get you know, to get this language to another level where you can actually use it on more real projects than just these examples. Concurrency and few other things are not there yet. As you can see, the goals are quite ambitious. I believe the order they are implementing things depends on the way they get money, basically, for the language, the way they get funded. So it's easier to show you know, your sponsor that you have graphical system working than to tell about new garbage collector thing you just made. Yeah, a few examples. I thought it's not enough code for you, so you can read a little bit more. Get the web page title is read the then the URL, and we parse it according to these rules. We are skipping everything until we encounter the string title, then the copy text into variable title until we find the closing tag. It is there. Remove all occurrences of the element from the list. So list has here some things in it. You can see the code there, but it's actually just a list of things. Until is the loop which runs block of code until it returns something, until it returns true-ish value. Essentially finds print in the list, removes two elements, so the print itself and the next element, and then the list contains something similar to code, but without prints. The last one is also interesting. It converts all the BMP images into the PNG ones in one line of code in the current directory. This is the file type, not a reader macro, but actual syntax for the file. So this is the current directory. Read returns list of the files for each loops, for each file, and executes this block of code. If it finds BMP extension in the file name, it runs this second block of code, which replaces in the file name BMP extension to PNG, calling save on that new file name with the data as load file actually loads data into memory in the correct format. It knows how to do this thing. And save, it sees that the file name contains PNG, so it will save in the another format. You can actually run all these examples, they all work. On to the live demo. So, I also was a little bit skeptical about the language. How can it be 1 megabyte of things? So these are the downloads. As you can see, for Linux and macOS, it takes a little bit more than 1 megabyte. I have it downloaded here. Yes. Can you see it? Yes, so 1.2 megabytes. I'm not sure how to run the LDD command on Mac, so it will show you all the dependencies, all the links to the external libraries. If you run it on Linux, it will show you dependency to libc, the Linux itself, and I believe libm, which is math. And that's it. Let me run it. So what I wanted to show you is just since you can edit the code, which are blocks essentially in runtime, it was very like one of the first things which come to mind for Lisper is I want to take the example from the website, so you can do the same if you're interested, and you know, if you don't believe in everything. So there's a small example here.
I think it makes sense to run it not in full screen mode, because you'll get window on different screen.
I think so.
Yeah.
How do you copy text on? Yeah, I'm a little bit old fashioned. I don't know how to use touchpads, you know, these things, they scare me.
Should I paste?
Yeah, you can do it. Just so you know, I didn't do anything. So, this actually in the terminal, you can see how ugly it pasted the things, but nevertheless, it works because indentation is not the case like in Python. Here is the window made with a view dialect, which inside has the text area. And in this text area, it takes the code. Each time it changed, it draws it, it outputs it into the panel on the right, which is right now showing us basically a time, which probably means I'm running out of time. So, for example, you can see it. You can change it to 50.
Yeah.
Yeah, not very cool, right? Something like this, and you don't try. If you don't like this color, you can put it anywhere. Purple. Yeah, let's make background purple. I'm a bad designer. I'm not a designer at all. So basically everything, and you can do it. So changing some things and looking how it will break. The second button. Yeah, it's the new style clock. Questions?
But it does have to.
It blows your mind, right? This is what Lisp should essentially.
It does have to depend on a lot of external libraries, like for example.
So, yes, let me comment on that. The guy who implemented this originally was basing his work on another language which is not known at all, called Rebel. And the author of the Rebel language, he has a lot of blog posts about how to write the language, what are the reasons. And one of the key things he also always mentions there is that the software is bloated with the complexity, with a lot of dependencies, a lot of things which are unnecessary or done very, very badly. And he thinks, he believes that concepts in this language, as well as ability to extend it with your own languages, will help you to find the complexity. And this is example of, but it actually can be done.
But how do you draw things? Like, what did you talk to? Did you talk directly to the X server, or
you draw things? You mean here on the screen?
Yeah.
It calls the native API. For Windows, it's Bin Forms.
Oh, yeah, but in
data.
Linux, for example, would you use the libx11
they
want, library?
They will implement the Linux backend with the GTK calls.
Okay, so that's a dependency, right? You don't implement the X protocol.
So it dependency, this dependency exists in Linux. For example, in Windows, you have graphical system embedded into operating system. Will you call this a dependency or not? Because if you have a Windows machine, can you have it without graphical libraries? Probably not.
But that's the difference between the velocity of the operating system itself, right? In Linux, you have to call the dynamic libraries.
You have to call.
Well,
you have to call something for the graphical interface. You can implement it in the language itself.
No, but I'm more curious because okay, that you can call native APIs. And
yes.
That's it, every system has. But I'm more curious because sometimes myself, I struggle a lot to convert BMP to PNG, just that. And that thing of 1 megabyte does it with code without any external library. I don't really get it.
So they have PNG decoder, JPEG encoder, BMP encoder and decoder, implement it in the language, put into 1 megabyte, and this is how it works.
Why would they put that into the core language?
this is a very, very good question. So,
what about flat audio decoding?
I think this will be the next issue. But the idea is they want to make a language which is so easy to use, but you can use it without like diving very, very deep into the field. So if you want to make a PNG BMP decoder in Java, I can imagine you have to use a library, you have to, I don't know, specify a lot of parameters and stuff and understand how it works, what to do with it.
I don't like buy this argument, because in this language, you know, you have to know how to use this this infrastructure. You have
in every language you need to know the infrastructure, but the conversion itself is hidden from you. The complexity of the conversion is let's say it's more hidden than in other places.
Anyway,
so here
it's more fun this way.
You can see things like this is the color. This is actually
a
color. This is not a string containing a color. This is the color itself.
So how long has been this project working?
I think
like
since 2012, so around 5 years.
It's interesting how they said, "Oh, we'll do the garbage collector later, but let's put
it
in."
Exactly. I think it has to do with how they are financed, how they are getting money.
Because I guess the interpreter is written in C, right? The interpreter is written in C?
No.
In which?
It's written in Rebel, the language which it based,
its
ideas on. But after the version, they want to finish the very important things until the 1.0, and then they will rewrite it in the Rebel itself. So it will be self-hosted, the proper.
So Rebel is it? So you said you're saying before it's proprietary. Language,
yes.
How much does it cost?
If you
buy it?
Yesterday the website was down. I'm not sure if it's back. Oh.
It's like it's down forever.
Okay.
It's dodgy. You can
yeah, but it was quite an old one. It's actually strange. I mean,
maybe not .org.
.com?
That's
where
but it's not online.
Is it possible to search in
Google.com?
Oh, it's .com? Oh, yeah.
We went commercial.
Yeah.
No, but wait, we have a saved copy.
So
we
wait.
Can do it.
Probably they have it implemented as well.
So it's an open source language in a proprietary.
Yes.
Okay.
I believe in the products you can buy it.
Okay.
These products are no longer available, sorry guys. You cannot get to this masterpiece.
It's only five people are
developing. But it's good, then it will be self-hosted, you don't have to know about Rebel anymore. Yeah, I encourage you to try it. 1 megabyte, no dependencies, zero install. It costs you like one click in the browser.
Who's the target group? Like 1 megabyte suggests that it's maybe bearable
it
for
is.
Mobile devices?
Mobile devices says on one of the slides that I was mentioning,
Android.
The plans for Android and iOS support. So you'll be able to compile your programs and interact with the native mobile environments in the same way. It has the cross-platform GUI engine, for example.
Isn't that the main goal, main direction?
Okay. It's a very, very good question, because I have an answer for this on the last slide, which I thought I will not show you, but apparently. So this is where it is, seen by its creators.
Everywhere,
exactly. It's called they actually should copyright this thing, full stack programming language. Like you have the full stack developers. You need a language for them.
Yeah.
Well, but the full stack here is much broader than the usual understanding.
So hardware?
Yeah, the idea is that with dialects you can go anywhere. You're writing your thing, which will be compiled to assembly code.
Yeah, but the semantics should be very, very different anyway, right? It's like the system interpret.
Yeah. It compiles to the native code without any intermediate things. So it has no dependency on C compilers or anything like that. It has its own compiler, its own bytecode, not bytecode, native code generator. In 1 gigabyte, yes.
And can it target other architectures or is it limited to x86?
I want to show you again because I feel like you are starting to believe me. Half an hour ago or something.
Yeah.
Let's see if we can find the web page. I think I see it.
No,
why now it says connection refused?
Maybe
this
is PDF.
Maybe there is no cached version.
No cached version. Seriously.
Anyway,
can you try remove www?
I think you
yeah.
have like in one of the slides that it can target different, so you can cross compile.
Yes.
Yes, it can cross compile. It's easy as I can't even show you, but I think Dmitry want to finish this. So cross compilation is done in red minus T Windows and your file. That's it. This is how I cross compile things on Linux, because on Linux the graphical support is not there yet. I cross-compile them to the Windows and I run them on Wine.
But what if you're running a Linux on a PowerPC?
Then the support will be there.
Okay, when you compile a binary,
yes.
How large is that binary?
It's about the same size, maybe even less, because you don't need interpreter and compiler. Maybe you need interpreter because you're maybe doing nasty things in runtime, but you don't anymore need the compiler. And what I want to do is here is the list of the compiler targets. Not all of them are implemented yet, but Windows is there, Linux is there, Darwin is there, for sure. Others will be soon.